see so clear what it's all about. So stay by my side when the sun goes down. Don't wanna forget how I feel right now. Jira, Jira, you are enough.
I know that you are.
Jira, you are enough.
So I will be
even
if it's right now,
in every circumstance,
cause I'm Lord the
Got it on.
Yes, yes, yes. Good afternoon, everyone. Please stand. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there he may be also. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one cometh to the Father except through me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment and in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this incorruptible must put on incorruption, and this incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality. Then shall we be, O dead, O grave, O where is thy strength, and O victory? The grave, where is the victory? For God giveth us the victory to our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. This afternoon, we welcome every one of you. This occasion is not always a happy occasion. But for those that know the Lord, and for those that know Christ, we will rejoice because our brother, he just passing away. Huh? He just passed away. We have nothing to worry about, because once he gone with the Lord, thank God, we will see him one of these days. And to those that love the Lord and know the Lord, we will wept, we will weep, we will cry. But church, let me tell you something. We will not mourn over. We will not do that. But we give God thanks and praise for the life that he have lived. And he have lived a good life. I said a good life, an ageable life. And we give God thanks for it. It's so many young people are not getting not even one score. He promised 3 scores and 10. And he gave him 3 scores and 10. And I always said, and he lived by reason. As he lived by reason. And God will help us. Many times we don't want the Lord, but this is time. This is time. I said, this is time. And I always make my remarks. When I come to funeral like this, I don't preach about the dead. I preach about the living, that they should know Christ. May God continue to help us. Let us pray. Father and God, we thank you this evening for the life that our brother have lived. A good life. 3 scores and 10. And by reason. I pray right now this afternoon that we are here, that we would think about God, think about Christ. The families missing, will miss him, will mourn, will go through all kinds of situation. But one thing I say, One thing I say, we should know where we bound for and where we hope are. I pray, God, that you will comfort the families and friends and everyone. For God so loved that he gave. God is our refuge and strength. A very present help in the time like this situation. A very present help in this morning. A very present help that we miss our brother. Sometime we know we would have to miss him. And sometime someone will miss us also. So I pray that we will set our affections on things above, which is the Lord Jesus Christ, not on the things of the earth. So bless everything that should be said and done to the honor and the glory. And in our blessing and in our worship and in our serving this afternoon, I pray that maybe someone will give their heart to the Lord and accept the Lord as their person and dwelling Savior. That is all it's about. May God continue to bless us right now in the name of the Father and the name of the Son and the blessed Holy Spirit. Let the church say amen. Amen. Oh, God bless you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good evening, everyone, and we welcome you this evening to this service of thanksgiving for Mr. Leslie Moore. We want to thank God for the investment he would have made in his life and his family's life. Many look around here this evening. This church and our community and our Barbados is rich because of what he did and because of the investment he has made. We're going to call on his son right now, Alfonso King. If you could kindly remain standing for the scripture reading, Psalm 46. Alfonso King will read that for us.
A blessed good afternoon to everyone. First scripture reading is taken from Psalm 46, New King James Version. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. Though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling, Selah. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts with us is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolations in the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brother Alfonso. Congregation, you may be seated. Prime Minister of Barbados, the Honorable Mia Motley, has sent her reason for not being here this evening because she is on overseas duty. I was told that a representative would be here. If that's you, we would like you please to indicate to us someone representing her this evening. Similarly, the Honorable Dwight Sutherland, MP, Minister for St. George South, is unable to be here with us this evening as well. And we are going to move smoothly along and invite you again to be singing with us as we invite the worship team, Jason Bell, and the worship team of the Ellerton Wesleyan Holiness Church to come and lead us in a song where it says, "In the sweet by and by." In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, definitely we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Worship team.
Father, rest over the way.
invitation. You may be seated. One of these mornings, we won't be here. If we know the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, we'll be gone in the sweet by and by. We'll have the following tributes coming in this order. And that is after the reading of the scripture, second scripture reading. Richard Nurse is coming to read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 58. And following on from him, we have a tribute being presented by Rudolph Moore. And then a tribute, which is a special song from the family. God bless you.
Good afternoon. Second scripture reading, 1 Corinthians 15, 51 to 58. Reading, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." Here endeth the reading.
Good evening, everyone. I have never shaken this much before, but today I am shaking, literally. Ladies and gentlemen, as I pay tribute to Leslie Moore, affectionately known to us as Uncle or Moore, he can only be described as a proper man. His life can be summed up in the song popularized by Frank Sinatra. The lyrics were rewritten by Paul Anka and set to music based on the French song Comme des Habitudes, composed in 1967 by Claude Francois and Jacques Revaux. I did it my way. Today, had he been able to speak, he with much exuberance would declare, "And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain." My friends, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway and more. Much more than this, I did it my way. Leslie was never afraid to speak his mind. And he was very unapologetic for things he believed in. He was a philanthropist in his own right, always giving and sharing, no matter if he knew you or not. Persons too many to mention will speak of the assistance they received from him, particularly those whom he helped, either to enter or gain citizenship into Barbados. He can be described as a Caribbean integrationist, and rightfully so. He was an author, the region's greatest CARICOM advocate, right-hand man. He was very energetic. He worked hard and played harder. But on weekends after the work came the washdown. Food and drinks and more drinks. Uncle worked 7 days a week, including bank holidays. As a private contractor, he could be seen building a house or paving a road or building some other capital project. He found employment for anyone who was willing to work hard. He was a consummate political supporter, a fierce adversary to anyone who echoed anything anti-BLP. He would say, "The BLP made me a man and put money in my pocket." And for him, that was worth defending. He believed that no one who supported the party well should be left out, and so he was responsible for placing me in government. When efforts by others failed to secure a job, he took me before former Prime Minister Owen Arthur, defending my stewardship in the party and putting forward the case on my behalf. I conclude, for what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows he took the blows and did it his way. Yes, Leslie, Uncle Moore's, did it his way. Thank you and good afternoon.
One, two. Good afternoon. It's an honor to be here this afternoon and a privilege. We, the family, will sing this song this afternoon in recognition of our father, Leslie Gerald Moore. The song is "You Are God Alone." Join us in the chorus. not a God created by human hands. You're not a God dependent on any mortal man. You're not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way. We're going to have an impromptu speech at this time. Present this evening is the Honorable Cynthia Ford, and she will come and just pay a tribute on her own behalf as well as her connection otherwise to the family. It is pretty clear to me that she's not representing the Prime Minister of Barbados nor the Honorable Dwight Sutherland, and she just wanted us to make sure that when she comes, she's speaking from her heart. Amen? Amen? Let's welcome her, please.
Thank you, Pastor. Distinguished members of the platform, Pastor Nurse, my dear friend, and families, of course, of the deceased. When you're a politician, they try to throw you at the deep end. But like any powerful Barbadian woman, I am going to step into the boots of any strong woman and make some very brief comments. I have not got any... Let you see my beautiful face, too. I have not got any word from the Honorable Prime Minister. I know she called me this morning because I, too, have got some grief. I've got a dear sister whom I look after. She passed away on Sunday evening, so she called to extend her sympathy and said she was at the airport going off to the Bahamas with a heads of government conference and then off to Trinidad thereafter. So I'm not so sure who is the person that would have been designated to fill in for her. How dare me fill in for a prime minister when I haven't got that kind of instruction. However, I felt it is my duty, having come here this afternoon and rambled a little bit, although I've been here before, but I so wanted to be here to lend support to Pastor Nurse and Brother Felton and, of course, the Moore family. And therefore, when I was asked just now impromptu again, throw the politician in the deep water, I thought it is only fitting that I will make brief comments because Comrade Dwight is not here either. And I know Brother Moore for an extremely long period of time, a man of honor, a dedicated worker. You know, nowadays people are employed or, according to my friend just now, Owen Arthur helped him with a job. But then they go in and they don't do anything useful. But you know what? Prime Minister sent me here, though. And I don't have to really do that. And I don't have to do this. No. Brother Moore was a faithful worker at MTW for many years. And indeed, he became a private contractor. And I speak with a measure of conviction, not from any political aspect, but from that moral and spiritual component. Because he was a powerful man, not only in his work, but in his looks. Big man. And we always had fond memories to exchange when we met each other. Actually, he would have been the father of the late Dr. Beverly Lashley, who was another powerful woman who passed away a couple months ago. And I happened to know her very well when she was teaching at Combermere. And then she was the pastor at the Hopewell Church for a while. And that is another congregation that I frequented, like I do Pastor Nurses in Bridgefield sometimes. And so I felt that it is only fitting because Brother Moore would have brought so many other qualities of being upright and honest, to be able to work for a full day's work, for a day's pay. And those are some of the things that we need to learn as people in this society. We give and we do what we have to do with an element of honor and later satisfaction because we would have done the best that we could do. And so the scriptures tell us well how to be able to comport ourselves to make sure that we do it right every time. You don't cut corners. You work a full day's work for a full day's pay. You spend that money wisely. You learn to be productive. And more importantly, you give to others who are in need. And I think that is even more critical at this time. Now that we are in suffering from this pandemic that seems not to want to go away, as well as so much high unemployment and people have no work, but we have so much food we cook on a Sunday. The macaroni pie, the rice and peas, the pork, the chicken, the salads and so on. And the neighbor next door has nothing to eat. We'll rather give it to the dog or throw it in the garbage. Not Brother Moore. He was a man who would give and give and give. And I think that that is a great example for a lot of us to follow, not only the young, but the older persons as well. I want to say how he will be fondly missed by friends and families, and that others will step into his shoes to be able to set that example of productivity, hard work, dedication, love, not only for family and friends, but love for Almighty God. And as long as we do that as a people, nobody can question us because we know that we have done what is expected of us as human beings living in a society serving each other in order for us to be able to make that mark to show that we loved God because we followed his commandments and we have done whatever we have to do. And so this evening, I want to take the opportunity, not only on my own behalf, but on that of the Barbados Labour Party, on that of those persons who would have been close to him from the time he grew up, from the time he started to work, who had to train and nurture him to be the kind of character and the kind of productive citizen that he would have made. And of course, he made that indelible mark in this society. And it is not that he would have been a millionaire. And therefore, we come here this evening to talk and propose about what he did in that level. But he was a giver of food, of funds, of love, affection, direction, discipline. And therefore, I highly commend him. And I would have talked to him many times in his lifetime. We would have communicated on the phone. As a matter of fact, a couple of weeks past, the nurse, he called me, asking me about trying to get somebody with a little employment. Can you imagine that? A man who was not so well, who would have been in his, not the wheelchair, but I would have seen him moving with an assistive device. And he even sought to ask about help for somebody who was in need. What a powerful man he would have been. And therefore, I encourage you, especially you young people here with us, live by example. Give to others and not look for anything in return but the love of God. And therefore, on my behalf, on behalf of the Barbados Labour Party, and on behalf of all others who would have known and met and loved and worked with Brother Moore, I extend deepest sympathy and ask you to carry on that legacy that he would have laid for us, because he made an indelible mark in the development of this society in many, many different ways. So I want to thank you very much for giving me the moment. But of course, like any strong Barbadian black woman, you throw me on my head, I land on my feet. May God continue to bless all of you as you mourn the loss of Brother Moore. I thank you.
Thank you very much, the Honorable Cynthia Ford. And you did extremely well. Amen. Amen. The eulogy this evening is being presented by two of Mr. Moore's son, Malcolm King and Rohan Moore. We invite them to come now and present that. Immediately after that, we'll flow straight into the worship team leading us in another congregational song.
Good afternoon once again, Chairman, Reverend Livingston Trotman, family and friends, cabinet members. It's indeed a great privilege to stand here and to give a eulogy of a great man that lays here before us. Leslie Gerald Moore was born in Newbury, St. George, to parents to the late Mr. Alexandra Beckles and Mistress Mildred Beckles. He was the first of three children, the others being my Uncle Oz and my Aunt Pastor Evelyn. Leslie was a bright scholar. That feels strange, you know. That felt real strange. I never call him Leslie in my life yet. That felt very strange. My dad was a very bright scholar. Having attended a modern high school, he went on to attend Commonmere School. On leaving school, he was first introduced to the masonry trade by a distinguished person in his hometown in Newbury, St. George. And later, he mastered the skill so that it provided him a reasonable way of life. My dad spent some of his formative years living in St. Lucia and Trinidad. I recognize where the connection come from now with CARICOM. And then on his return to Barbados to start a life of his own. My dad was an excellent, he had excellent work ethics. He was an excellent supervisor. Later retired as a consultant in the Ministry of Transport and Works. There's so many people around that worked with my father in the Ministry of Transport and Works. And so many people had called me and said, had not for my father, they would not have been where they are in life today. I thank God for his life. For a period of over a year and some, he was assigned to the people of St. Peter by the late Honorable Owen Arthur. He worked at a station in Jerusalem. And the people of St. Peter can smile better when more was around, because they know that things would happen. Roads would get fixed. And anything they want done, Moore made sure that it was done. My father was a self-accomplished, and later he was honored. You know, he was honored by the late Governor General, the latter years of 90. And also, he was an outstanding JP in our home. All the folks around in Good Intent, Ellerton, and all around can attest to the good work done by my father. They can call upon him anytime, and they will call him, and he's always willing to help them. One thing that is going to be missed, we remember we learned to appreciate the St. George Valley. That scenic look it is right now. When you come on evenings and you see a long line of traffic and you're moving slow, you know at the end of top of that line is G1215, my father. Slowly heading home. That is going to be missed. My dad was a man of few words. But when you hear old G's on, you know there's trouble. And he had a way that he only had to give you a look. And that look tell 1,000 words. But if you are angry with my father, he had a way that he had a smile. Anybody know Leslie Moore? Always remember him first by that smile. When he gave you that smile, he make your knees buckle. I see why so many women were attracted to him. Come on. You understand? When he gave you that smile, their knees buckle. And you had a choice but to smile back. You know, that he had such a calming and addictive smile. That was my father, Leslie Moore. And let me tell you something. He's a man of few words. But when you get in, if you want to talk, get in a political conversation. And he can out-talk you. And let me tell you something. Don't say nothing against the BLP neither. Let me tell you, man, you get tongue lashing out this world. He stood up for the BLP. And he lived the BLP. My dad was a father and a friend to many. And one thing I can say, as Rudolph said, he did it his way.
Good afternoon, everyone. Protocol has already been established. I stand here today on the shoulders of our great ancestors, from which I now draw strength to deliver a part of this eulogy of our dad to you, our family, his friends, and invited guests. As you have heard earlier from my brother Malcolm about our dad, and usually with Malcolm and I, in our younger days, I always go first. But there's some things the elder brother has to go, so I can follow from him, man. And I'm sure he did a fantastic job, as you all would agree with me. The late Leslie Gerald Moore. What further can I share with you about our dad that you have not already heard. A great person once said, and I quote, "It is not how a person dies, but rather what counts most is how they lived." That says how they live. That says truth is worth repetition. So now I can entreat you to continue to listen to some more highlights of our dad's amazing life journey. Now, Leslie Gerald Moore, while still in his prime, and a handsome young man, I say a handsome young man, he met the love of his life, Monica Sinel Moore. Moore, now deceased. He was a man of real substance. I say he was a man of real substance. He had substantial wealth. As Monica bore him, listen very carefully, as Monica bore him four kings. I said four kings. Within four consecutive years. Beverly, now deceased, Errol, Alfonso, and Malcolm King. Following the birth of the kings, Leslie decided to take a break for one full year to celebrate, rest, and recuperate. He needed it. I said he needed it. After 1 year break, listen to this very carefully. After his 1 year break was over, he decided as a fine and respectable young man in society to do the right thing. And he said he decided to man up. He and Monica, because you know when you got a good thing, you got to hold on to it, man. I said when you got a good thing, you got to draw it close. And they were married. Or we would say hitch, as they call it back in the day. And the following year, along came one more. M-O-O-R-E. Rohan Moore. That's the inside joke. My dad was committed to his marriage to my mom for 37 years until she passed. I remember my mom would always prepare the food and have it seasoned with a piece of pigtail. You remember that? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Which I never saw until she shared my dad's food. The only remains I saw of that salt meat, because in those days, the old folks used to season your food, man, with salt meat. If it wasn't seasoned with salt meat, it wasn't the food at all. I don't know how you ladies do it today, but in those days, it was good. And the thing is, the only remains I saw of that salt meat was the evidence of the bones that was left on his plate after he had graciously finished destroying it. You could have never come between my father and his salt meat. I heard the minister thought he was a sharing man early in her speech. And I agree with her to this point, though. He never shared this point, man. And as the man of the house, he got the lion's share, and he knew that very well. Leslie. I can recall, while living in Bermuda, and visiting Barbados on one of my many vacations to the lovely island, I would take the opportunity to drive my mom around to visit her friends, because normally she wouldn't get to see her friends. When I came in, I would take her around and show her friends, and she'd have a good time, which she would not have done otherwise. When it came to a certain time, though, of the day, she would always say, "Son, it is time to go home." She wasn't going home to rest. "Time to go home to prepare your father's meal." My dad would always have fresh cooked meals every day. I said we'd have fresh cooked meals every day. I guess that passed on to me too. Chefet restaurant and other fast food franchise would have never stood a chance with my dad supporting them. If beating was a crime back in the day, I said if beating was a crime back in the day, Malcolm, my dad would be in prison. We go visit him. He believed that to spare the rod is to spoil we children. As a youngster, when my brothers and I were subject, not just to punishment, but to heavy punishment, man, my Lord, I can feel them blows now. My mom would have a saying, wait till your father come home. If your child did something wrong, punish him right away. But when she said, wait till your father come home, that was torture, man. Not just torture, but mental torture. And all this time, listen to this, all this time, I was praying that my father would not make it home. Oh, Lord. I was praying that he'd get hit by a bus. And the funny thing is, he used to drive a car. My dad was a very reliable and selfless person. I recall several times whilst I was living abroad, and my dad was building my first home, he would drive from Greaves, St. George, where he was living at the time, to Wainworth's Garden, St. Philip, during the wee hours of the morning, just to keep an eye on my building material while others were getting their material stolen. He never once discussed payment for himself, but rather look out for his workmen instead. When it came time to the end of every work week, my dad would make every effort to socialize with his workmen, although he was firm about having the work completed. He was highly respected for connecting with them. Leslie was a father to many, and he did not leave anyone out. He cared for and was like a godfather to many in our neighborhood. An example like Anderson, Cranston, just to name a few. His love for people and to see them succeed in life stretched beyond our borders. He had always a love for his special friends, like Robinson, Alsop, Gerald Tull, and Andy the Jammer Hart, just to name a few of so many he had. O'Neill, Sash. Gerald, he would always consult regarding a second opinion when it came to his many building private projects as a private contractor for many or most of his life. Andy the Jammer would work with him as a senior mason on many private projects. And during my dad's latter years, he would visit him and refuse to allow him to drive himself, but chauffeur him wherever he wanted to go that day. He was also known as the driver of G-1215, as Malcolm would have related to that earlier, and kept that license plate until his passing. He would graciously change his vehicle every 4 years. And the thing is that nothing was wrong with the vehicle. Religiously, and maintained that them in excellent condition. You could have seen your face shining as a reflection after he had finished undergoing his daily cleaning routine at home every evening after work. My dad was a very fair and respected person. He was a man of integrity, as you heard earlier. He truly loved life and helping people. He taught me how to truly care for a vehicle. which I had clearly demonstrated with my first vehicle while living at the time in Bermuda. Daddy, as we call him, as he was affectionately called, you will always be remembered, and I will truly miss you. I hope that you have found peace within yourself, and may you continue to rest in peace and rise in glory. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
How great is our God?
That is it. The name of Jesus.
anyone else as great as you are. We salute you this evening as we give you thanks, O God, for the life of Brother Leslie Moore. We pray now, Heavenly Father, that you would continue and remain with us in all that we would do. We ask that your anointing would flow now through the speaker, Reverend Felton Nurse, who would come to challenge your people with God's word. May there be your words. Use him as your vessel, that as he speaks, O God, it would be as though you are speaking directly through him. We pray, O God, that what he speaks will challenge our hearts, but more so, it will change us. These things we ask in Jesus' name. And we all agree and say, just these things we ask in Jesus' name. And we all agree and say, you may be seated. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, someone. Can we praise the Lord? I know we are in a funeral setting, but remember the funeral setting is for the living. You know, my uncle, Leslie, he cannot hear anything now, but we are alive. Are the people, the persons, the one who can and will accede to what is being said this evening. First of all, I want to greet the host pastor of this church, our Reverend Libby Trotman, and we go way back many years. Good to see you again, sir. Also, we acknowledge in our presence the parliamentary representative for St. Thomas, our Honorable Cynthia Ford. Also recognizing one of the officiant ministers, my mom, Pastor Evelyn Nurse. I greet all the relatives of my uncle from the Moore, the Kings, and for those who I cannot remember. But my uncle Beckles, Audrey Beckles, is also there. I greet friends, relatives, and loved ones. As also I see my representatives from my home church at Bridgefield, over to my right, to your left. So I think I've covered everyone. I greet everyone in the wonderful name of Jesus. When I came here a couple minutes earlier, someone gave me a joke that introduced me as the speaker for the hour, and I laughed. All right, because at funerals, we're not about that length of time. I just want to stir your moments, get your attention for a few minutes. Because remember, the funeral is for the living. You see, the person who has died, you can die after long suffering, you can die violently, you can die suddenly. So it doesn't matter about the dying, that is inevitable. But what is important is the living of how you live. So this message will be for all those who are alive. Praise God. Are you alive? Are you alive? Oh yes, wonderful. I really enjoyed that eulogy. It brought back a lot of memories. Thank you so much, my cousins, for ably putting it together. For a few minutes, I just want to engage your attention. And my text will be taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 to 4. And it reads as follows. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. So I think in that scripture, I would have covered most of everything of life. Now, funerals are a time of remembering, and it's also a time of comfort. And there's appointed time, as the scripture says, for everything under the sun. A time to give birth, a time to die, time to plant, etc. But the book of Ecclesiastes is unlike any other book in the Bible. Here's some interesting things. Rather than have stories to encourage faith or instructions on how to live, or anthems of praise and glorifying God and praising God, it contains a philosopher's reflections on life. And sometimes we have to take a time and reflect on life. You know that? We need to. Because sometimes we get so busy going doing this and that in our daily life, sometimes we don't reflect on life, you know, and see where I am today, where I was the other day, and things like that. But we need to take a little time. And the author of Ecclesiastes encourages us that he wants to reflect on life. He does not paint or attempt to paint a picture that is perfect, but rather a picture of life that is realistic, that is pragmatic, that is sobering in his assessment of life. What he's actually saying that life is not all about beauty. Life is not all about happiness. Because in the midst of life, there's death. But the life is also about pain, and it's also about loss. So therefore, life also includes the whole package about the laughter and joy. But as I say, there's also the heavy side to life. Life includes the whole package of light and darkness. So perhaps the author wanted to remind his audience that death is part of the process of life. It is part of the rhythm of life. So we see that inherent in his admonition in the message, he is telling us, do not waste away your days because you will not be here forever. I'm going to repeat that in case you missed it. Do not waste away your days because you will not be here forever. The scholars do their research and they say that the author of this book is Solomon. And when you look at the life of Solomon, he was one that was blessed in glory. The Lord blessed him with wisdom, understanding, knowledge. He was blessed with wealth. You know, he elevated to the position of king. He had it all. And then on that was the light side, but on the darkness side, he had a problem. I don't know if that's a problem of the black power. I don't know. Because if you check the origin of Solomon, his mother Bathsheba from the Hittite tribes were from the black tribes. And that is who David fell in love with. That's where he lusts after first. And eventually he married her. And we see Solomon talking. Solomon 1 about how his brothers, you know, are making sport of him because of his dark skin, etc. So we see he, for those who are dark and have a problem, men, we are wonderful. Look what happened with Solomon. But make sure you don't do like Solomon. Now the darkness takeover is that he fell in love with a lot of strange women, all right? That took away his heart, that took away his love from the things of God. We don't want that. But the important thing is that after he has lived life to the fullest, he said, you know what? All is vanity. All is meaningless. So this is a man who has been from the gutter to the top. He knows about life. And he's saying to us, and he's saying to you and I, that all that we have gone through, life can be meaningless unless you at least put the life attached to something worth living for. So all is vanity. That's what Solomon's saying. So these words that Solomon's saying, they were said centuries ago, and they are very applicable now for today. In that for everything, there is a season. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Are you encouraged this evening? Praise God. We know that we are all creatures of time. By the way, we set our clocks. I have one of my cousins who wears one of the biggest watch you can ever think about on his wrist. So, you know, we are creatures of time, you know. We want to know what hour it is, what time it is. We have schedules. We have appointments to meet, so we set the dates on the calendar that we would not miss those, you know. And then we want to know, then we have a large amount of times that we measured by the months and by years. We know generally when is the summertime, and we know when is the rainy time. Like last week when people were complaining about the heat, the Lord graciously open the heavens and bless us with some showers. So we know all of these things. But perhaps time should be measured in more than hours or days or years. Listen to this. Perhaps time should be measured by the relationship that we have with others. What do you think about that? Yes. Time should be measured by the relationship is why we have it, Father. So that is why we are all here today, to celebrate the life of my uncle, Leslie Moore. So the question can be asked, what time is it for you today? What time is it for you today? We are at a funeral, and therefore the obvious one will be that it is a time to sorrow. The writer of Ecclesiastes encourages that there's a time and season for every event, a time to weep and a time to mourn. And we would definitely be in sorrow because a loved one has gone on. Yes, we would be in sorrow because a close friend has gone on. We would be in sorrow because someone who we can depend on to get things done has gone. And there's no coming back unto the judgment, as the Bible let us know. So it is not wrong to sorrow or to experience loss. But those who are believers in Christ, we do not sorrow like the unsaved. All right? Because we as Christians have a hope, and we're reminded that he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. So we'll have a hope. So despite the fact that we will mourn the loss, we know there is hope, because when we are absent from the body, we are present with the Lord. So it's all right to sorrow, but remember, that is not the end. The question asks, what time is it? Again, it is a time to remember. St. Luke and Acts chapter 9 tells us about a certain disciple named Tabitha, which by interpretation is called Dorcas. And this woman was full of good works and alms deeds which she did. Then Peter rose and went with them. When he was come, they brought him into the upper chamber, and all the widows stood by him weeping and shewing the coats and garments which Dorcas made, which she had with them. Here the Bible therefore speaks of a godly woman who was remembered by what she left behind. The question can be asked, what did my uncle leave behind? What did he leave behind? Funerals can be categorized as bitter sweet. They are bitter because you've lost a loved one, a close friend, family. But they're also sweet because you have so many memories that you can share. And I'm thankful that God has made us with the capacity to remember. There's an old song of yesteryear, which was made popular by Tom Jones, which tells us that memories don't leave like people do. They always stay with you. Whether they've been good or bad, there's never something that you had. So we have memories to stay with us. I can recall some memories of my uncle. As a young boy growing up, he probably had the only Austin Cambridge in St. George, and that was in pristine condition. The younger generation would not know what I'm talking about, but they can look it up on the three W's. They're very good at that, okay? The World Wide Web, right? Austin Cambridge, pristine condition. I have memories also getting my first ride. You know, right? I didn't really enjoy the ride because I believe if you carry me for a ride, you should carry me at least a mile or so. But you don't carry me in stone throw up my house and tell me that's a ride. But nevertheless, it is a memory. Praise God. And I thank him for that. I also have memories that when you get on the wrong side of my uncle, you hear these words, you're no good. You're no good. And when he tell you, you're right off. You're done. You're no good. But this is after he has tried with you, okay? So I have those memories, and some of you have those memories too. So it is good to have these memories. There are good times. There are funny times. There are good experiences. There might be bad experiences. But all of them come together as we celebrate the life of my uncle, Mr. Moore. So the question is for you, the congregation, ask yourself, what will you leave behind? Again, I want to remind you that it's appointed time for everything. Everything under the sun, everything under the heaven, once you're on this earth, there's appointed time for that. So to you, the congregation, it is time to do something of importance. It might be a time to live. It might be a time to love. It might be time to make a difference in your life. It might be a time to change the direction of which you are heading and start to turn around. It's time to change your course. It is a time to be born again. A time to find God's will for your life. So in all of your getting in this world, remember, do not leave out the time for the Lord Jesus. Do not leave out the time for Jesus. Solomon many centuries ago said, all is meaningless, and he lived it to the fullest. You can achieve all these things in life, but unless you have a life filled with Christ, who is the center of your life, it can become meaningless. So the time is for you to reflect on your life and give Jesus a time in your life. Praise God. The question asks again, what time is it? It is a time of comfort. It is a time of comfort because Jesus said, I will never leave you or forsake you. I go to prepare a place for you, and I will return to take you with me. If you believe in me, even in the midst of death, if you believe in him, he will never leave us nor forsake us. Now, that is some very encouraging news. That if we believe in him, he will never leave us. So you see, the Easter message is the tomb where they laid him is empty. Jesus is no longer in the tomb. Hallelujah. He is risen, and he has gone to prepare a place for you and I. But we have to go through this life. We will meet obstacles. We will meet different things within our path. Sometimes we meet a little bump in the road. Sometimes we meet a hill. Sometimes we meet a mountain. Sometimes it is a valley. Sometimes it is sunshine. Sometimes it is rain. But in it all, Jesus said, he will never leave us nor forsake us. All right? So therefore, the same way how Jesus was raised up out of the tomb, if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you too can be raised from your situation. You can be raised from your tomb of sin. You can be raised from your tomb of circumstances. All you need to do is believe in the Lord Christ Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, every one of us has this one thing in common. If there's nothing else we have in common, is that as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we are staring death in the face. We do not know how or what time death will come for us. So we can hide, we can run, we can do all of these things. We do not know when death puts in its face and it comes for us. It might be next week that death will call us. Or sometimes we were on our way to death, and by some miracle God placed in the doctor, we were saved. Or sometimes it's some miracle drug. But eventually, one day, I said one day, praise God, death comes knocking. And therefore, no doctor or no medicine, all the good things that we do and all the wealth that we accumulate, they cannot stop death from coming. The word of God says in Hebrews 9, it is appointed unto man once to die, then afterwards the judgment. So reflect on that. I once heard someone says that there are only two things we must do in life. That is to pay taxes and die. But you know that is not always true. Because in this society, some people don't pay taxes. They don't. But you know what? They're going to die. You will die. Death, you can't get away from death. In the Bible, we are told that Methuselah, he lived to be 969 years of age. And it looked like he would never die. He would live forever. But he died. Sarah would have lived for 127 years. You see, Enoch would live for 365 days. And to bring it home literally, we had a great magician, Houdini, who escaped death hundreds of times and his death-defying tricks, and he walked away. But one day, he faced death. I said, one day, he faced death, and he did not walk away. So we all have to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. That implies that death is always close by. So there's no reason to treat people unkind. There's no reason to get your wealth on the back of people of honest work, things of that nature, people who work honestly for you. No need to treat people unkind like that. Death is always with us and is always close. And we do not know when death is come. We shall live today with the fullest, with the knowledge that any day can be our last. But we, the believers, have hope, praise God, as we pass through this land. We are just pilgrims, and therefore, we are just for a time. Of course, you will need the niceties of life. Nothing wrong with that. You can have all the nice cars. Nothing wrong with that. You can have the nice homes. You can have the nice clothes. Nothing is wrong with that. The nice jobs. But in all of your getting, remember, do not forget the Lord Christ Jesus, all right? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. So you have permission to achieve these things in life. But just like Solomon said, all is vanity, all is meaningless. Make sure you have Christ at the center of your life, all right? So the good news is when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we do not have to live in fear, because the psalmist encourages that, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And so again, I will ask you what time it is. It is a time of grieving. It is also a time of remembering. And it can also be a time of comfort for you if we but trust in Christ Jesus our Lord. And as I close, for the whole family, I trust that you'll be comforted. I'll just leave a verse to this song that is very rigid, riveting, and it would apply to us, and it will take it to our hearts. Very simple song. It says, one day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking from you. Give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday is gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never come. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. May the Lord add a blessing to your hearts in Jesus' name. God bless you.
Thank you very much. Good word from God to us this evening, delivered by Reverend Felton Nurse, nephew of Mr. Moore. Thanks again. God bless you. God bless you. We'll be having a recessional in just a moment, and we'll be reminding you that the second part of the service, which will be the burial, will be done at the churchyard of the St. George Parish Church. However, before we get there, we're going to invite Deaconess Harris to come and to offer up prayer for the family members.
Good afternoon to everyone. It's a blessed good afternoon. Bless the Lord. Let's bow our heads as we reverence God this evening. We thank God for his word. We thank God for everything that was said and done. And right now I commit this entire congregation, Lord, into your hands. Lord, in particular, I commit the family. Bless God. Bless the Lord. I commit the family into your hands. I pray, God, Lord, as I commit the Beckles, the Nurse, the Moores, the Kings, Lord, that you promised to take care. For you said in your word, Lord, that blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. And God, I pray for comfort this afternoon. I pray for strength in the name of Jesus. For Lord, you said that when we are weak, Lord, then you are strong. Lord, you lay your everlasting arms under your people, God, and you strengthen them. Lord, sometimes when loved ones are taken from us, Lord, they're taken so quickly, Lord, unexpectedly. Lord, and we wonder at times, do Jesus care? But the writer say, oh yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with our grief. For when the days are weary, hallelujah, and the long nights are dreary, we know he cares for us. Father, I pray this evening that the many things that were spoken about the deceased and even the legacy that he has left behind, Lord, that someone will take it and run with it. Lord, there's so many qualities in this life, and he has gone on. He has taken his rest, and we are left behind to carry on. Father, we give your name the honor, the glory, and the praise. Lord, I present our pastor, nurse, his sister, into your hands in particular this evening. Lord, I pray for strength for her. Lord, in times like these, Lord, when she would feel weak, Lord, I pray for strength for her. For God, we know that you care and you understand. Lord, remember Osric Beckles. Lord, I pray too, Lord, that you will cover him by your blood. Lord, you will touch him in the name of Jesus. And all the others that would be mourning and weeping. Lord, you said your heart is touched. Lord, your heart is touched. And you also say, Lord, that you weep with those that weep. So because of that, Lord, as we leave this evening, Lord, I commit everything into your hands. And I pray that we will carry on everything that we can take hold of. And I give you your name the honor. I give your name the glory. I give your name the praise. For Lord, without you, we can do nothing. Leslie have done his part. He have taken his rest. And we are here left behind. I pray, Lord God, by the mercies of God, that you will hold our hands. And there are those of us, Lord, at times when we would shed a tear and we would cry. The word of God says, tears are language that God understands. So because of that, I give your name all the honor. I give your name all the glory and all the praise. Touch this entire congregation. And to you we give praise. In Jesus' name is thanksgiving. I say in Jesus' name is thanksgiving. We call it done, honey. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, giving life to those in the tomb. The Son of Righteousness is gloriously risen, giving light to those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death. The Lord will guide our feet into the way of peace, having taken away the sin of the world. Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name, saying, "Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that was prepared for you." Leslie Gerald, into paradise may the angels lead you. At your coming, may the martyrs receive you and bring you to that holy city, Jerusalem. Amen. Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me.
I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart, therefore, is glad and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man, born of a woman, has but a short time to live. Like a flower he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow he flees and never stays. In the midst of life we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother, Leslie Gerald, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother Leslie Gerald and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus, Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants, who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus, Christ our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. And may his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. And the Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon him and give him peace, now and forevermore. Amen. to him come we that love the Lord. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like these sea billows roll, whatever my lot you have taught me to say, it is well with my soul. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more. When the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore. And the roll is called up yonder. I'll be there. The day thou gavest, Lord, is ended.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Remember, O Lord, this your servant, Leslie Gerald, who has gone before us with a sign of faith and now rests in the sleep of peace. According to your promises, grant unto him and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. And now to God's gracious mercy and protection I commit you this night. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this night and forevermore. Amen. Do you have any?